My name is Morgan Pearson, and I'm presenting What's in the Water Team Mural Edition. So what I'm going to be presenting to you today is we're going to figure out what the unknown compound is in a contaminated water sample. So we're going to be doing this by using infrared and nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. So we're going to be using these tools to find out how we can read their spectrums that they produce, and by reading the spectrums we can then narrow down our compound to just one option. So the purpose of this experiment was to identify the unknown compound in a contaminated water surface sample by using spectroscopic techniques. So according to the groundwater contamination article, over 50% of the United States use their groundwater for food and water. So it's important that we keep our water clean, because food and water are our main necessities. So this experiment was important because it helped us identify the contaminants in surface waters so we can properly treat them for a better use. So IR and NMR both measure the amount of electromagnetic radiation that is absorbed by a sample. So according to the Chem 120 lab manual, IR is an absorption of a photon that creates an increase in the energy of a molecular vibration. So we use IR to see the functional groups that are absent or present on the spectrum. So in NMR, it's the absorption of a photon that leads to an excitation of a hydrogen nucleus. So the NMR helps us see the different kinds of hydrogen atoms that are present and the relative number of those hydrogen atoms. So how infrared spectroscopy works is in this experiment, we used a sample of our surface water and we put it in between two glass discs and we inserted it into the infrared machine. And so then there was a source of radiation that went through the surface water and it absorbed the photons, which led to an increase in the molecular vibration. So then the detector produced an IR spectrum. So NMR works in a similar way. We use the surface sample and we put it into the NMR machine, which then the tube spun around and had a radio frequency radiation that was broadcasted into the sample. So the hydrogen nuclei of the water molecules absorbed the energy and the resonance spectrum produced an NMR spectrum. So we used the spectrums to look and see which functional groups were present, and we're going to be using NMR to look at the different types of hydrogens. So this table one is a chart that we look at to determine where the peaks fall under the range of absorption to determine what functional group it is by looking at the information from IR. So for example, the first functional group has a range of absorption of 3500 to 3100 wave numbers, so we can say that it is a functional group of OH. So this is an example of what an IR spectra would look like after it's produced. So the first wave, or the first peak, has a wave absorbance range of about 3400 wave numbers. So by looking back at table one, we can see that it falls underneath the absorption for an OH functional group. So we can say that the first peak has an OH functional group. And the other peaks on this spectra, they do have functional groups too, but those ones in this specific experiment, we're only looking at six different functional groups. So these ones, if they do not lie underneath the range on the chart, then those ones can be ignored. So we need to further look at an NMR spectra to determine what our unknown compound is. We can't do it without looking at both of them. So NMR, this is an example, and it shows that there are three different peaks, which means that there are three different hydrogens in the unknown compound's structure. So the peak ratio in this case would be 2:1:3, which means that there are two hydrogens versus one hydrogen versus three hydrogens. So then in this experiment, these are the 15 possibilities of the compound's structures. So we use these compound structures to make a chart for IR and NMR, and we use this information to look at the functional groups and the hydrogens that are present. So for example, the first one, methanol, it has an OH functional group on it, and it also has a CH functional group with H bonded on a single carbon. So we can fill out this chart of the 15 possibilities, and there would be an X in each functional group that is present. So we just did the same thing for the rest of them by looking at the structures. And this chart is also used for looking at information for NMR by looking at the structures. So looking back again at methanol, we can see that it has one hydrogen in the OH functional group versus another hydrogen in the CH functional group. So there are two different hydrogens, which means there's two different peaks. And the peak ratio would be a one hydrogen versus three hydrogen. So therefore, it would be a 1:3 peak. So we put it in this chart, and we filled it out for methanol. Two peak ratio, or two number of peaks is two, and then the peak ratio is 1:3. So that would be methanol. So in this experiment, this is what my unknown IR chart would look like. So the first peak has a range of absorption of about 3,368 wave numbers. And looking at table one again, that falls underneath the range of absorption for OH functional group. And the second peak is also strong, so that one's 2,973 wave numbers, which falls under the functional group for a CH functional group. And the rest of them, they are also functional groups, but those ones do not fall under the range for table one, so we're in this case not going to look at those. So here are the range of absorptions for the functional groups that we just found in my unknown for IR, and they do fall underneath the correct functional groups. And so out of our 15 possibilities, these are the four that do have the OH and the CH functional groups, CH with a singly bonded carbon. So we could narrow down our possibilities to methanol, ethanol, T-butanol, or to propanol. So to further determine which compound I have out of the four, we need to look at the NMR spectra. And this one shows that it has two different peaks, which means that there are two different hydrogens. And it has a peak ratio of 1:9, so that means that there's one hydrogen versus nine other hydrogens. So out of the four that we narrowed down, the T-butanol is the only one that has the correct functional groups and the matching peaks and peak ratio that we're looking for. So therefore, by looking at IR and NMR spectra, we can see that it is called T-butanol. So to further determine if it is T-butanol and to prove that IR and NMR was correct, we can look at T-butanol structure. So by looking at the information from IR, we need to look at the functional group. So the first one is OH, it does have that, so that's good. And then the other one, it has CH functional groups. So IR was correct by looking at T-butanol structure. To determine if NMR was correct, we need to look at the hydrogens. So this one does have one hydrogen on the OH functional group versus nine other hydrogens on a separate functional group. So there is 1:9 hydrogen, so the peak ratio and the number of peaks are correct. So therefore, this unknown compound is T-butanol. Some background information on T-butanol. According to the tert-butanol alcohol article, T-butanol is a very toxic alcohol, so it could cause several problems if it was exposed to people or the environment. It's very highly flammable and very water soluble. So to determine whether or not why it's water soluble, water is the universal solvent, so its molecules are very polar, just like T-butanols. So the polar molecules have similar molecular structures, which is why they do mix really easily. And so this is why we need to avoid T-butanol spills in the environment, because it does mix really easily and it's very hard to clean. So the material data sheet for T-butanol states that if T-butanol was consumed, it could cause liver problems, kidney problems, or even if it did have a large consumption, it could possibly lead to death. So therefore, with T-butanol in this contaminated water surface sample, we need to make sure that this water gets treated properly in order to have a clean drinking water and a clean life. So these are my references, and thank you.